is really lovely to see you all here this morning. Just a quick reminder that you need to have either checked in with your QR code or somebody at the door, and that it's great if you can sit during the service in your family groups. You do not need to wear. You can't hear me yet? You still can't hear me? Hello? Hello? This is as much as I've got. I lost my voice during the week. I'm sorry. So I will speak closely to the mic. Is that better? Yeah, you do not need to be wearing masks during the service, but we are unable to join in with singing at the moment. So enjoy the singers who will sing for you and reflect on the words and find worship in that. I believe we'll hear some more this about an event that's happening this afternoon later in the service, and just letting you know that we had a lovely time at Kids Club on Friday night. We had about 18 kids out playing putt-putt, having a great, crazy, chaotic time. So, as we come to worship this morning, we remember once again that the ground that we walk and worship on is sacred. It was created by God, and it's been cared for by many people over the generations. This morning, we particularly acknowledge the traditional custodians of this land, the Awabakal people, and we give thanks for their care of it. May we honour and learn from their traditions, and may we always walk forward seeking justice and reconciliation. Amen. Now, call for worship this morning. The morning stars profess God's glory. The waking birds harmonise a refrain of grace. The sun warms us with God's hope. The night sky whispers peace to our sleepy souls. Creation's voice echoes continually in our hearts, reminding us of God's steadfast love. Our wisdom is shattered by God's absurd love. God's vulnerability strengthens our feeble faith. God's words place joy in our hearts. We follow them to peace and hope. Amen.
Isn't it great to be in God's presence together as a community? Let's celebrate as we sing and lead for you here in your presence, Lord.
Presence.
Your voice, it thunders. The earth is yours.
So I'm Beck and this is Alanka, and we're just here to talk to you because tomorrow is International Women's Day, and the campaign this year for International Women's Day is Choose to Challenge. And so, oh, there's a video that we're going to play now.
Yep. I look forward to International Women's Day each year, because it gives us the opportunity to thank God for the women who are contributing to our world, our church, our government, our communities, our families, and our friendships. Who are the women that you are giving thanks for in your life and communities? I give thanks for the women who've been leading our health response to the pandemic, their expertise and wisdom, their steady, compassionate, and scientifically based approach to keeping the community safe. I give thanks for women who are leaders in politics, calling for a just and fair Australia, advocating for legislation and funding programs that ensure gender equality and equitable opportunities for women everywhere. I give thanks to women of the Uniting Church, who are leaders in our local churches and other councils, shaping Christian communities of welcome and hospitality, and responding to the issues of their particular contexts. When I was a young adult, there were women in our synods and assembly who were passionate about justice, arising from their experiences of the liberating and prophetic ministry of Jesus. They nurtured in me an understanding of the interconnectedness of the good news of Christ and a compassionate and just society. Some of these women are now in their 80s and 90s and continue to advocate for people seeking asylum and refuge in our country. Women and children impacted by domestic and family violence, and they advocate for peacemaking efforts through the campaign against nuclear weapons. I'm also greatly encouraged by younger women who are leading the way in calling for the transformation of our church and are speaking prophetically about addressing climate change and calling us to hear God's call for the renewal and the healing of the whole creation. On this International Women's Day, I invite you to give thanks for all the women who are leading the way in your communities and churches, embodying God's vision of love, justice, and reconciliation for us all. Thanks be to God for these women.
Amen. Yep. It's hard to follow that, but I'm just going to let you know a little bit of information about what we're doing this afternoon. So this afternoon from 3 o'clock to 5 o'clock at Fiona's house, we invite all women of the congregation to gather together for a time of community to experience how powerful women and women's work can be in transforming communities, in supporting lives, and to do a little bit of advocacy for women's missions around the world, where women are using the skills and crafts that are often dismissed as women's work and devalued to actually transform their lives and support their communities. And so we'll be doing a little bit of women's work, letter writing and crafting, and also talking about the powerful nature of women gathering in community to transform lives. I know it seems perhaps a little bit odd to celebrate International Women's Day as Christians, but as Deirdre Palmer incredibly aptly and said, there is a fundamental link between faith and supporting those who are marginalised or those where injustices are still being perpetrated. And unfortunately, as many strides as we've made as a society, women still don't experience the same kind of equality of experience of life and opportunity that men do. And so it's going to be really interesting to think about perhaps not only thanking God for the women in your life and the incredible leadership and skills and gifts that they bring, but also to think about times where you can say no to injustices, no to when someone perpetrates a stereotype about women and their skills. You know, when someone, for example, is a gifted scientist or a brilliant thinker, but all people talk about is how they look or their ability to keep a clean house. And maybe say yes to changing systems and changing ways that we talk about and value women and their contributions. So I leave that with you, and I encourage any woman that is available at 3 o'clock tonight to meet at Fiona's house. Just let Fiona or myself know if you'd like to attend. We're bringing your own afternoon tea, bring your own craft if that's something that you're interested in, but lots of women also aren't interested in crafts at all. So we're going to have letter writing templates, and we're going to write letters or talk about how we can write letters to support women's causes both in Australia and overseas, and share a little bit about our times when we visited women's missions overseas.
Thank you.
sorry. No, you're right. This afternoon, the other part of it is it's really about us being together and gathering as women together in solidarity and enjoying each other's company and uplifting each other and just being there for each other and having some fun. So, you know, as Alenka said, there are still some injustices that we are facing, but there's also a lot to celebrate and to be joyful about, and we do that in community. So we look forward to seeing you there at 3 o'clock.
And if you can, the colours for International Women's Day are purple, green and white, as we are so aptly demonstrating.
It's for the photo opportunity. Yeah.
Big thanks to Alenka and Beck and Fiona and all those who have been involved in the organisation. Let's pray. Gracious God, who gathers us together, who says yes to us and to the creation which has been given to us as a gift. We give you thanks for all the times when we have been shaped by the saints of the church, by the faithful people in the world. And we give you thanks especially for the women in our midst who have made us and formed us and brought us into a life of gratitude and grace. As we gather again in this place, loving God, we give you thanks for the way in which we have been cared for and we are able to care. The way in which we can stand against with quiet strength those people and institutions which would make us less than human and so often have cut off parts of our society and made them less than human. We give you thanks for the opportunity to stand in solidarity together, to do craft if craft's our thing, to get angry if getting angry is our thing, to write letters if writing letters is our thing. We give you thanks for the opportunity that we together, because it means we don't have to go it alone. That you are always with us, but you provide a community of faith to walk with us. We give you thanks, especially, loving God, for the opportunity to change the world. And we give you thanks that we are never helpless. But we also acknowledge there have been too many times when we haven't said no, or we have said yes to the wrong things, when we haven't said no to injustice, when we haven't said no to sexism and misogyny, when we haven't said no to violence against women, when we have fobbed it off as just a police matter. For those times we say sorry. Call us, shape us, renew us, and make us better than we are in our worst moments. Gracious God, help us again to be a people of faith. And let us acknowledge our sin and your mercy as we sing together, "Forgive Us Now."
Forgive us now, O God of love.
That God is gracious and just and welcomes us always back into her fold. And so we are able to declare to each other, indeed, that our sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. The peace of the Lord be with you. Please take this opportunity to share a sign of peace with those near you without running around too much.
In today's Kids Talk, we're talking about our choices within life. Imagine there's a massive invisible bubble around us, and everything within that bubble is everything that we find easy to do and say yes to. Everything outside that bubble are things that we say no to because it's hard for us. And sometimes it's hard to say no to a lot of tasks that people ask us to do, and that's okay. In our life, a very big challenge for a lot of us can be saying yes to eating vegetables and no to sweets. There's a lot of temptations, but we must remember that saying no is okay and saying no can be the answer. We're going to watch a quick clip about a dog saying no to eating his favorite treat because he's being patient. When we talk to God and we pray to Him and we ask Him for many, many things, He will say yes to a lot of that. But if His answer is no, always remember that that's okay. Be patient, just like the dog, and who knows, maybe later on your task that is on the edge of your bubble might fall into your bubble and you'll be ready to take it on. Always remember to bring it back to Him because He's always ready to listen.
To Today's reading comes from Exodus chapter 20, verses 1 to 17. Then God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the very house of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol, whether in the form of anything that is in heaven above, or that is on the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing children for the iniquity of parents, to the third and the fourth generation of those who reject me, but showing steadfast love to the thousandth generation of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not make wrongful use of the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not acquit anyone who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you, your son or your daughter, your male or female slave, your livestock, or the alien resident in your town. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but rested the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and consecrated it. Honor your father and your mother, so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house, nor you shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or male or female slave, or ox, or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor. These are the words of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Our God, we give you thanks that at the beginning of our understanding of you, which we have so often got wrong, you remind us that you deliver us from slavery and you call us to be liberating people. As we consider your word to us today, and as we consider especially our commitment to justice and reconciliation and solidarity with women here and around the world, let us remember our identity, our first identity as your people of liberation, of new life, of love and grace and forgiveness. Amen. When I was a boy, my mother taught me to knit. Or at least she taught me how to knit a row of plain and a row of purl. And except for too many drop stitches, it meant that I was very skilled at knitting scarves, but not much else. I never got to casting on or casting off, and after a little while, I stopped learning. So I probably didn't learn how to knit at all. Now, I probably never had the patience to really learn how to knit. I get distracted pretty easily, and my attention to detail is not what something like knitting needs to make at least anything wearable. But no one in my family dissuaded me from knitting, and I can't remember anyone explicitly telling me that I shouldn't, that it was, if you like, odd for a young man to knit, or that it was women's work. No one said that to me. But if I'm completely honest, I reckon I probably got this view kind of by cultural osmosis. The general vibe of school where the boys seemed to love sport and woodwork, but seldom stuck with classes that involved sewing and knitting and sewing on. Most of us boys and girls enjoyed learning how to cook, perhaps. I think that was because we got to eat what we made at the end of the class. But very few of my male friends pursued knitting or sewing or anything like that seriously. I think times have changed a bit, but I still feel there are some powerful and overarching ideas about who should learn what, when, and why. And sadly, these too often are divided along gender lines, aren't they? This week, we celebrate International Women's Day. I think it's Monday if you want the exact date. But the theme for this year, this Women's Day, is Choose to Challenge. And that's about encouraging all women, all people, not just women, to challenge gender bias and inequality in the world. And this is a really, really important undertaking that needs to happen more, doesn't it? Some of the women from this congregation are gathering this afternoon over a cuppa and craft. And the focus will be looking at some of the things that have been dismissed as women's work, as Alenka indicated earlier. And then looking again at the way in which these activities have actually helped and continue to help women find their way out of oppression and poverty in many places in the world, out of economic and cultural oppression. There is a sense this year that reclaiming so-called women's work, especially handicrafts, can be an act of resistance against sexist ways of looking at the world and helps to join women everywhere in some kind of solidarity. And that's good. And that's good. The reading for today comes from the book of Exodus and contains one of the first iterations of the Ten Commandments, handed down from God to Moses at the beginning of the formation of the covenant into a law that guided the people of Israel. And when most of us think about the Ten Commandments, we tend to think about the knots, don't we? The thou shalt nots. The thou shalt nots of murder. The thou shalt nots of adultery, theft, or bearing false witness. Oh, and you really shalt not covet your neighbor's ass, whatever that means. But these Ten Commandments are only ten of about 600 or more. Scholars argue, but I think it's about 613 or 616, depending on how you count them, of 600 or so commandments in the Old Testament. And all of them, to Jewish scholars, are of equal status to the ten. But many of which are outmoded and outdated today. Many commandments that made sense 3,000 years ago, but now, not so much. Commandments about shellfish. Who likes their shellfish? Prawns and the like. Yeah, okay. Probably couldn't if you'd obeyed all the Old Testament commandments. Commandments about mixing milk with meat. You can't cook with milk and meat, so you can't have cheese with your burger. Sorry, Marty. And so on. Even if we go back to the Ten Commandments, commandment number four about the Sabbath is barely practiced outside conservative and Orthodox Jewish households. Even if you allow a slight reinterpretation to say, make Sunday the Sabbath. Most of us don't obey the strict letter of the law when it comes to the Sabbath, do we? You see, the most well-known of the Ten Commandments, and all commandments really, are the ones that say no. You can't do this and you can't do that. And sometimes we think that's a good idea, and sometimes we think, maybe that was an idea for an older day. The thou shalt not. And thou shalt not do set the boundaries of what is permissible for a community. And they should be set quite universally and broadly. You really can't, can you? You really can't have a social functioning order where violence and deceit and thievery are practiced without sanction. If we all lived that way, things would fall apart. And I think today, especially after a week or a month we've had in Australia, in a week that we are celebrating International Women's Day after a harrowing set of stories of sexual assault and cover-up, we do need to say no, too. We do need to set some boundaries. Thou shalt not assault anyone, but particularly thou shalt not assault women. And thou shalt never cover it up when it happens. It is a great sadness that this commandment is not as ingrained in us as it should be. And all of us, but especially men, must do far, far better. Thou shalt not. But not all the commandments are about no's, about sin. setting boundaries on the fringe of what's acceptable. And that's good, because we need both boundaries, but we also need encouragement and direction and purpose within them. Some of them, and some of the most important, I would argue, are about showing us how to live good lives, the positive commandments about how to be gracious in the middle of the field of play. And some of these, I think, we are mentioning again today too. Love the Lord your God. Base your life on love and gratitude for something beyond yourself. Acknowledge just how wonderful is the gift of life, of creation, of community, and of love itself. And as an added bonus, as we get better at loving God, we also get better at loving others, at loving our neighbors, at loving our enemies even, at loving the world we live in, and for many of us, the hardest love of all, to love ourselves. Loving God is a good way to start a good life. Remember the Sabbath day. This could be interpreted very strictly, but the point of this commandment, I feel, is actually to remind us to make space in our lives together to consider and reflect on what is important, to attend to worship and community, to acknowledge God with gratitude and find rest and rejuvenation for life. Remember the Sabbath day, for you need it. We all need it. We all need it. Honor your father and mother. Value the people, especially family, who have taught you and formed you. Now, this is not just about blind obedience or whitewashing the problems of the past, but rather from learning carefully from it. Interestingly, for an ancient document written in a highly patriarchal world, the inclusion of honor for mothers is powerful, and we should remember that. Even back then, when the men had all the power and the women did what they were told, theoretically, we were told to honor our mothers. It may seem strange to us some thousand years later, but this was actually a powerful and a radical thing to include in the earliest of the commandments. And so we need to celebrate those people who taught us to care, who taught us to love, who taught us even to knit, however badly we do that. Part of today, part of our thinking about women, about thinking about commandments, about thinking about what kind of world, what kind of society we want to live in, is about saying no. About saying no to the stuff that takes us beyond the boundaries of healthy human life together. And my understanding is that for many women, there is a pressure to say yes in all sorts of circumstances where the correct answer is no. In these times, I pray that our communities of faith and prayer will give strength to those who do need to say no, who do need to maintain boundaries, both individual and corporate. At the same time, however, we need also to develop a good life within the boundaries, within the commons of life, if you like, a life which is filled with choices for good, that say yes to community and care, that values God and values the world, that honors the things that we have been taught and honors the character of the saints who have gone before us. We do this when we gather on Sundays, and in a special way, the women of this congregation will do so again this afternoon. Because we believe that if we are empowered and energized, if we are filled with grace and purpose, if we find our lives shaped by the promise and love of God, we will be better able to stand strong, to find our voice, to share our gifts and talents, to craft a new and better future. And in this is good news for us all. Amen. to reflect on a hymn of praise that reminds us all of the goodness of giving thanks. Praise with joy the world's creator. Mentioned last week, there are many of us who have made the difficult or confusing transition to putting our offerings in online because that's kind of what we've had to do over the last year, because collecting money and putting our hands all over it has been something a little bit problematic. And so we haven't really been doing offering prayers in church that much, and we need to do that again. So let us pray and give thanks for all those who contribute to the life and work of God in this place and further afield. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all those who give of their time, their effort, their talents, their money, for all those who are turning up at Kids Club and Youth Group, who are preparing for Cooker campouts, who are gathering for Bible studies and craft groups, who open up, who mow lawns, who wipe down surfaces, for all those who make our community run. We give you thanks for the way in which you take our gifts and our talents, the things that we are able to give, our money, our time, the frailness of our talents. We give you thanks that you are able to transform them and grow them, that we may touch the lives of many. And in so doing, our lives are reframed, reshaped, and remade. This is good news, and we give you thanks. Amen.
Time of prayers for others, and today I want those prayers to come from you. Imagine every one of you with your thoughts and hearts sending up prayers to God, not just from my voice. So I've suggested, I've got two prayers for each category, but you can add your own to it in your silence and in your heart, from your heart. Or light a candle for each category and have time then to reflect and pray yourself. When I say loving God, then can you respond with what's on the screen, substituting world, country, church and families. Let us give our prayers to God. For the world, we light this candle and we think of Myanmar unrest. Think of the prayers for the world, day of prayer for Vanuatu, wanting us to remember after their cyclone and COVID and lack of tourism. And we think of New Zealand after their earthquake. So let us just reflect on your own prayers for our world. Loving God, listen to our heart's longings for the needs of our world. We light a candle for our country, for the COVID rollout, maybe for an environmental issue like Kakadu National Park and the trouble that they're having with the management of that, with Indigenous and National Parks. And for women in the workplace that we've heard so much about this week. Please bring your prayers for our world. Loving God, into our heart's longings for the needs of our country. We light a candle for the wider church. Again, Vanuatu has asked us to pray, and the Uniting Church, through our partnership, have asked us to pray for the working together to end domestic violence, where 75% of women experience domestic violence in Vanuatu. But the programs that the Presbyterian Church is really helping. Vanuatu have asked us to pray for the youth leadership, that we pray for Indigenous cultures across our islands and the world, that they can retain their traditions and customs. I'm sure you have needs and no longings for our wider church. Loving God, listen to our heart's longings for the needs of our church. With our focus on women and families, let us focus on the wisdom of women leaders in our country, in our community, and in our church. Let's pray for grandmas, aunts, daughters, granddaughters. And during this time, we'll bring the needs of our church family. We think of Darren with his broken collarbone. And we think of Lynn still recovering. and the other people on your hearts. Loving God, listen to our hearts' longing for the needs of our women and families. Knowing you are hearing us, Lord, we offer these prayers in the holy names of God. Amen.
As we gather together around the table of our Lord, we've got some rules, some no's, and some yeses. I'll remind you that the way we're going to serve communion this time is someone will come to you in your seat and serve you. They'll serve you the bread first. They've got sanctified and sanitized hands, and they will take a piece of bread and put it on your hand. Let them serve you the bread, please. So just open your hand out flat so they can put it on there, and they'll sort of drop it on. Then they'll come around and each of you can take a cup from the communion trays. Remember that however we share this meal, with all its awkwardness and unfamiliarity, and yet with its deep familiarity, it is a table which sustains us and nourishes us. But it doesn't belong to us. It is actually really good news that we acknowledge that this table, that this meal, is not something that belongs to us, nor does it belong to the church. This is the table given to us as a free gift by our Lord Jesus, and it is by his will and command that we are able to share here. So come and share in this meal if you love the Lord a little and would love him more. There is nothing you needed to do to earn your place at this table, and nothing you could have done to exclude yourself from it. All are welcome here. Let us pray. Our God, from the beginning of time, you have loved your creation and you have sought out and redeemed your people. In so, so many ways you have visited us, in word, in covenant, in law, in prophecy, and finally, in sending us your Son, Jesus. He came and shared our life, the life of an infant, a child, a youth, and an adult. He rejoiced with those who rejoiced, and he wept with those who wept. To the despairing, he spoke words of hope, and he healed the sick. He was always a friend to the rejected. And yet, despite his goodness, he was betrayed and was nailed to a cross. But in the end, and beyond the end, you lift him from the grave, and you restored him to life that he might be with us, and we with him, alive with evermore. And so it is with joyful hearts that we remember how this meal was gifted to us. Recall how on the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, thanked you, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." We remember too how when the meal was done, he also took the cup of blessing and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and drink. All of you, this is my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, do it to remember me." So following Jesus' example and command, we also ask a blessing on this bread and this cup. Loving God, pour out your Spirit upon us and upon these gifts, that they may be for us the body, healing and nurturing us for the road ahead. And that we may become for you your body, loving and healing and forgiving in the world. Amen. The bread we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. The cup we take is a sharing in the blood of Christ. These are the gifts for you and for all the people of God. I invite those assisting with the communion to come forward. Thank you.
thanks, Almighty God, that you refresh us always, and especially at this table. Strengthen our faith and increase our love for one another. Let us go from this place united, encouraging in peace, and rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our final hymn, sending us out into a bright new day. To say no when we need to say no, but always open to the yes, to enter into community, to support one another, and to find justice and love in the world. May the blessing of God Almighty, Creator, Son, and Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
Bless you and keep you, and make his face shine gently on you. The Lord be gracious unto you.